Okay, in this video, let's look at using GitHub Copilot. We're going to look at using the Autocomplete feature, which is probably one of the most common ways to use Copilot. You type out some code, whether that's a function, iterative loop, conditional statement, whatever it is that you're doing, and Copilot will try to anticipate what you want to do and offer some autocomplete suggestion ideas. So let's begin by creating a simple function. I'm going to create a function that uses a Caesar cipher, and let's see if it can then generate the rest of the code body for me. I create the function name definition and set the parameters for the function. Okay, let's begin by creating our function definition. I mentioned this is going to be a Caesar cipher. We're going to be encrypting. We're going to send in text, and we're going to be using a shift value to do the encryption. And then it's saying encrypts a string using the Caesar cipher. That's fine. We can accept that doc string. But what we want next, of course, is the other doc string. For some reason, it's not doing the other two. That's fine. We'll take that. And we want the body of the code to be generated. And here we have the suggested body by Copilot. Let's take a look at what we have before we accept it. So we begin with a variable which has a blank string for the encrypted text. We're then looking at every character in the text value that we pass in. We're checking that it is, in fact, an alphanumeric character using the isAlpha function here. And then we're checking if it is an upper case or whether it is a lowercase. We are then looking at using ordinals, which is the ordinal value for the character using the UTF code point system. And we are just shifting it using the shift value that we have here. We are then using some extra encryption techniques we have here. Rather than just shifting it, we are minusing a arbitrary value of 65. We're then using the modulo division divided by 26 and adding 65. And over here, if it isn't upper, if it's lowercase, we're using an arbitrary value of 97. Again, modulo by 26, then adding 97. Seems to be doing some extra encryption for us rather than simply shifting it a set number of places. That's fine. We are still achieving what we want, which is encryption. And it is iterating over every character in the text, doing this encryption. Then it is adding these characters to the blank string here to create a new string, which is going to contain the encrypted values. And then it is returning the encrypted string. So I think on the surface, this looks fine. So let's, in fact, click tab, accept this. Now the next thing to do is to take this for a spin and test it out. So let's create a print, and we're going to, it's already anticipating. We want to call our encrypt function, passing in the string hello world with a shift value of 5. Let's hit okay with that. We'll accept this. And then if we put a comment here, it's actually anticipating what it thinks the encrypted value will be. Very good. So we'll save this. Let's run this and see what we get at the console. Here we go. We're running, and the output, in fact, matches the expectations. So this encryption function seems to be working just fine. That's great. Now, when you've encrypted something, oftentimes you need to decrypt it. Let's see if we can create a decrypt function and see if Copilot can understand we want to decrypt using the same approach we've used here for our encryption. This is clearly the point that we need to reverse, because if we don't reverse this, we're not going to be able to decrypt. So this is a good test to see if Copilot can use the context of our code to create a decrypt function, which in fact undoes the encryption. Okay, let's go to a new line. Let's create this function, and let's call this Caesar cipher decrypt, and we'll pass in text and shift, and let's see if it can figure out what we want to do based upon the original function. Give it a moment. And let's have a look at what it's got here. Decrypts a string using the Caesar cipher. And as we can see, it is using the opposite approach to what we have here, which is great. This is exactly what we want to see. Let's now accept this, give it a test, and see if when we pass in our encrypted string, we actually get back hello world. And look, it's even giving us a suggested test case. It recognized that we tested for hello world up here, and it returned this. And it's saying if we add that in with a shift of 5, we should get hello world back. We could do that. Another thing we could do, I think, is rather than just assuming that we are using this static value, let's create a new variable by encrypting some original text, then passing that variable to our decrypt and ensure that we get the right thing back. That way we're not looking or depending upon Copilot telling us that it only works for this exact string, because maybe it doesn't work for all of the strings. We can't just assume that it's correct, right? So we're going to ignore this. And we're going to do something else, okay? So let's have a look at this now. So let's create our own test setup here. Let's start by creating a variable, call that text. And let's make this the original unencrypted text. And let's just call this hello hacker. Great. Now, we want to call our encrypt function to encrypt this and begin to assign the return to this variable here. Let's call this R. There you go, it is anticipating what we want to do. Copilot is being helpful. Thank you very much for that. So we have encrypted that text and returned it and assigned it to this variable. We could print out what the encrypted text is. Why not? Let's see what it actually is. Now what we want to do is decrypt this text by using our new decrypt function. Let's create another variable called decrypt text. And look at that. Copilot is anticipating what we want to do. We want to decrypt the encrypted text. Very helpful. Thank you for that. Now the next thing, let's do this. Let's print out the return of checking whether or not decrypt text is in fact equal to the original text. Now, if it has decrypted it properly, this should return true. So let's save this and run this now and see what we get. Yep. So we've saved this. We're going to run this and let's check the console. And what do we get? There we go. We get the encrypted text being printed out. And that is in fact the same as what was expected by Copilot. And when we have decrypted and done this conditional check and printed out a Boolean result, we are seeing a value of true, which tells us that this has worked properly, which is fantastic. There we go. Our decryption function does in fact reverse our encryption function. And everything is working as you would expect. That's really, really great. Now, if you're brand new to the idea of a Caesar cipher, maybe you're slightly lost at what we're doing here, just take a quick second to just discuss what this actually is. At the simplest level, all we are doing is that we are shifting the alphabetical characters within a word so many places to the right or to the left, depending on how you set up your Caesar cipher. So if you had a letter of A and you had a shift of 2, you might shift that from A to B to C. That is a way of encrypting the original letters or characters within a word and then turning it into something that's encrypted and hard to understand. Obviously, this Copilot version of the Caesar cipher isn't simply just shifting, it's doing some extra calculations here, but you could in fact remove these and look at simply shifting the ordinal point. And that is what you could do by looking at the code point from the UTF code base for the characters. But that's fine, we don't need to get into that right here. Just in case you weren't certain what a Caesar cipher was, now that you know. Now, we have had a look at some really good examples of autocomplete by looking at encryption and decryption. Let's stay on the theme of strings and look at creating a new function for checking whether or not a word is a palindrome. And as I'm sure you already know, a palindrome is simply a word which reads the same both in forwards and reverse. Let's create a new function here. Let's call this isPalindrome, pass in some text, and let's see if Copilot can intuit what we want to do. There we go. Checks if a string is a palindrome. And what does it do here? Okay, there's a few different things going on. It converts it to lowercase. That's a sensible idea. Obviously, if you have a capitalized word, then it is not going to read whether or not it's a palindrome or not, because capital letters and lowercase letters do not compare and return the same value when looking at them as characters, because the UTF code points are different for capital and lowercase letters. And when you're doing a comparison, you're looking at the code point, not the actual letter. Next is replacing any blank spaces with no blank space. That's a great way to get that out of the way. And then if you have a sentence, for instance, you want to get rid of blank spaces and put all the letters together, which is what it's doing there. Finally, it is reversing the original text using this little section here. It's simply using, oh, I've just got rid of that. Let's see if it comes back. It is reversing the text by simply saying, okay, let's use slice. There we go, it's back. We're using a slice. I'm going to hit tab just to accept that. We are using a slice notation by using -1. We are saying, use all of the characters in the sequence, which is a string, and return them in reverse by using the -1. And we are returning this conditional check. Is text equal to the reverse text? If it is, it is a palindrome. That should return true. If it is not, it should return false. That's fairly standard. So let's now accept this. This looks like a good function to me. And create some manual test cases to see what we get. And let's see what it does here. See if it comes up with some suggestions for us. So I want to check, is palindrome? And let's see. Ah, there we go. We have a suggestion from Copilot, which is a really interesting check. Not looked at this one myself before. A nut for a jar of tuna. And apparently that should return true. And I think you can read that and see that does look, in fact, to be true. Let's see if you can understand. Ah, there we go. Fantastic. Not a palindrome. It has looked at a true and a false case. So this is really good. You can see that Copilot is understanding what it is that we're doing. We're looking at testing this function. We've started off with a true scenario. And we've then moved to the next line and we want to do a second check. And it understands if we've checked if something is true, we probably want to check if something is false as well. So it has given us a false test case. So you can see that Copilot is able to understand the context of what it is that you're doing and be a great AI coding assistant or AI pair programmer by coming up with suggestions that make sense. Now, before we test this, let's comment out our previous code over here because we don't want to check that right now. going to save this file, run it, and see what we get at the console. So we'll run this file now, and we should see true and false, and we are seeing true and false. Excellent. Everything seems to be working, and this is a great function. Now, before we wrap up this video, let's take a second to talk about what we've done here to understand why it is working well for us and what we could be doing to make sure that it does continue to work well for us and what we should avoid to ensure that it doesn't work, okay? So, as you've probably noticed, all of the function names I've used have been quite intuitive. They've made sense. If you read a function called isPalindrome, you probably understand it wants to check whether a word is a palindrome. The same goes for Caesar cipher, encrypt, or decrypt. They're descriptive. They explain what it is that they want to do. And we need to do this to ensure that Copilot can understand what it is that we want to do so that it can help us properly. If the function names were nonsensical, Copilot would not know what you want to do, so how can it give you great advice or suggestions on what you want to do next? So a great way of illustrating this is to look at a very simple example to show how Copilot will take a guess at what we want to do based upon this nonsensical name I'll create. But who knows if that's what we want, or who knows if Copilot will ever get it correct. Without a really well-formed function name or well-formed code, Copilot is going to struggle to understand how it can help you. So let's have a look at something like this now. This is a function called x blah y, which means nothing whatsoever. It is nonsensical. What does it suggest for this? It returns a list of string with blah in between x and y. That's a really interesting idea. I can see why it's come up with that concept. Maybe that is what we want to do. Maybe it's not. But of course, this is a fictitious example to show that with a hard to understand and a nonsensical function name, Copilot is going to take a guess what it thinks you want to do, but it's very unlikely to land upon what it is you're trying to do. So in reverse, if I delete this and I create something called reverse string, pass in text, I'm fairly confident that Copilot will understand what we're trying to do, and it does. It reverses a string, and you can see it is using that slice notation again to return the reverse of the string. Now, if the function name makes sense, Copilot can understand it and it can help you. If it doesn't make sense, Copilot will try to help you, but there's a very good chance that help is not going to be helpful at all. So the main takeaway here is that when you're using Copilot, only use it when you're coding in a well-formed and well and easy to understand manner. If you are hacking or putting something together very quickly, if you want to test something out and you're not using correct conventions for function namings or using single-letter variable names or other things that you wouldn't use when you're coding at production grade, maybe you don't want Copilot switched on because it may not be as helpful. It might actually become a hindrance because it's trying to guess things that aren't what you're trying to do because it can't keep up with your quick, rough and ready hacking style when doing something like that. On the other hand, if you're doing something that is production grade or something that is well put together and you're using correct naming conventions and Pythonic approaches in terms of your function names and variable names, Copilot can be very helpful, as you've seen in this example. So let's just delete that for now. We can wrap up this video. And the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to explore how we can use Copilot to generate some test cases. So rather than looking at these manual test cases that we've been doing, which are perfectly fine for quick, rough and ready tests, let's see how Copilot can help us to create test cases for the functions we've created. So I'll be looking at that in the future video. Hope you'll join me in that, and look forward to seeing you there.